Welcome back to a brand new episode of CountryBoyz. It's been a while since we've done an episode, and it's been a while since we've gone to the Middle East, where we're going today for this episode 26 special. How do you pronounce this country? Let's take a guess. Everyone gets their own guess. You go first.
Qatar. Qatar,
yes.
I've always said Qatar.
I generally did. And in the last couple of years, someone corrected me.
I think everybody said Qatar.
Whoever corrected you is kind of an idiot, because there's multiple ways of pronouncing it. They're cool with, say Qatar. You can say, I think technically it's not Qatar, but it's like Qatar.
We're still saying it wrong when we think we're saying it right.
But no, they've actually, they're cool with people saying Qatar. They're just like, whatever, that's fine.
But I thought everybody was trying to correct them during the World Cup. I thought that was the whole, like, everybody was trying to correct how it was being said during the World Cup.
Well, everything that I saw, they're just like, either way is cool. It's like potato, potato.
Oh, okay.
So.
Well, wait, who says potato?
I don't know, but some people do. Maybe British people? I don't know.
I don't think potato, potato is a real thing.
Well, it used to be, and then people realized potato is stupid.
What about tomato, tomato?
Do you walk around saying tomato?
I mean, no.
Yeah. So either way is cool, but hey, I think Qatar sounds cooler. Qatar, I guess, if we're speaking Arabic, but we're not. So we're speaking English. So look, anything goes. So, and if you haven't guessed it, we're going to Qatar. Second time in the Middle East, like we just said. The first country we went to in the Middle East was Qatar's little neighbor, Bahrain. And that was a while ago, but I think we'll see some similarities between the two.
Bahrain was super rich.
Yeah, Bahrain was super rich, and Qatar is more rich.
More rich?
Way more rich.
Okay.
Bahrain it's basically just like a mini Qatar in a lot of ways. There's definitely some differences, but we'll go into that. So I feel like we've been getting some bigger boy countries, like we said on the last couple ones. We're moving up, but I feel like now it's super small, so still by the country boy standards, it's a tiny country,
physically small.
Yeah. By international standards, I feel like we're at a pretty big country as far as money and influence and power. So
right. Nice.
So let's get into the rundown. So the capital is Doha, and basically everybody lives in Doha, like 80-90% of the whole country. All lives in the surrounding areas or the metropolitan area of Doha. So when you say you're from Qatar, you're 99% chance you're from Doha.
Right.
There's a couple smaller cities around, but basically everybody lives there. So the size, it's about 11,000 square kilometers or 4,400 square miles. So about the size of Connecticut.
Which is tiny.
So tiny. Population, so it's about 2.7 million. So there's a couple weird things with their population here. So it's 2.7 million, but only maybe 10% of the country are actually native Qataris. So basically everybody there is an expat or there for work, or it's super rare to find somebody who's like an actual Qatar, you know, has lineage from Qatar.
Right.
So that's one of the weird things.
So what is that 2.7 number made up of?
So around 300,000 are OG Qatars. Then I guess it's like 25% are Indian, Bangladeshi, which are mostly there as like migrant workers.
How many, 20%?
About like a quarter.
Oh, okay. 20%.
And then the rest are still migrant workers, but basically like Filipino, Southeast Asian. There's I guess a like somewhat decent size amount of European expats who live there, but it's a pretty big mix of people,
right,
from all over. But most of the people there are there to work, not originally from there. And yeah, but the other weird thing with this place, and I guess because everybody goes there to work, It's a sausage fest here. It's 3-1 males to women.
Oh, answered one question for me.
So Jason's not going
I'm
there.
Out. I'm fucking out, dude.
Hold your vote to the end, all right?
No, I really don't know what's going to change things. There's a reason I haven't been to Alaska.
Yeah, well.
Get good at arm wrestling, Matt. You know, you could arm wrestle a lot there.
What?
Yeah. Go to a...
that's my new hobby, yeah.
By the time you come home, you'd be good.
Okay. Yeah, no, come on. Just us guys, right? We can throw down some arms. So they speak Arabic, but they also speak English. Like, I think pretty much everybody there can... You can get by with English.
Right.
It's made up from people from a lot of different areas, and it was an English colony back in the day at some point. So
okay.
They're pretty fluent in English, and I think most of the people who are the 10% like OGs, I think almost all of them go to school in America, England, sure. abroad. So they're well studied. So I think it's pretty.
It's one of those countries that has everybody has an English accent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they say mate, the probably.
King's English.
Yeah. And I don't know if it is now. I feel like every country we go to that's like this says they have the highest GDP. But at some point, whenever I pulled this stat, it said it had the highest GDP. I also saw other things where now it's like third highest. Either way, it's like 120,000 or something's the average, which is kind of crazy when you have all these migrant workers who probably aren't making anything. Like, for that to be offset by
right.
the people who are making a shitload.
The amount of wealth that's in the country.
Yeah. But I want to say that Monaco, I feel like that had to have been the highest GDP, but I don't know.
You mean per capita or whatever, right?
Yeah, yeah per yeah, person. Yeah.
Monaco.
Yeah, yeah. Highest.
I have a hard time believing it's average. Not Monaco, just because the population is so low.
Yeah.
Right, but right.
So, nothing but wealth. But I don't know. Either way, they're rich. Most people here are rich. And as a result of that, it's... one of, if not the safest countries in the world. So basically there's no like natural disasters that are a threat there. There's no crime. Unlike other places in the Middle East that are more unstable, this place is not unstable at all. Very, very well protected. So, hey, when you're there, you like we would probably be the biggest threats if we went there, like to the society.
I mean, America. Anywhere, pretty much anywhere CountryBoyz go.
Americans, carnage.
No, I'm saying us specifically.
Us,
okay. Yeah.
So that's a bit of the rundown. Let's get into the physical geography of this place. So as you'd imagine, super dry, flat, desert, super desert here. There's, I think 2% of the land is fertile, arable, whatever.
Right.
Whatever the word is for that, but it's mostly sand dunes, sand. I think the highest point was like, I don't know, 100 or 200 feet. That's like basically a sand dune. So
the big dune, though.
Yeah, big daddy dune, as they call it there. So it's a peninsula. So Bahrain was like a little island that was connected by a land bridge. This is actually connected to Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. That's one of the only borders that it has. The rest of the country is just surrounded by water. So it kind of juts out from Saudi Arabia.
What body of water is it?
It's in the Gulf, the Persian Gulf.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And
decent beaches here?
They do have beaches here. So there are like beach.
Is Doha near the beach?
Doha is on the water.
Okay.
I think you might have to get out of Doha to go to the beaches, but they do have like resort type
places
you can go here.
Yeah.
Because it's so arid, there's no flowing rivers, no like natural water. I guess they probably have like underground water sources, but yeah, you can't go catfishing here.
Damn it.
No streams.
Night spearing.
Yeah, but it's crazy to think about a place that just doesn't have a river or I guess they have man-made lakes, but no, yeah, you can't go whitewater rafting here, which sucks. Also, physically, this is why they're so rich. But so just outside of the northern border, they basically sit on a split gas reserve with them and Iran. And it's they control most of it. But basically, they're the third largest. They have the third largest reserve out of any country of liquid natural gas.
Oh, shit.
Which is different than regular natural gas, I guess, because with liquid, it's easier to store.
Transport, too.
Yeah. So it's Russia, Iran, Qatar, and it's like 13% of the world's natural gas or liquid natural gas.
Qatar has 13%.
Yeah.
Jeez.
So that's why
They're so wealthy.
They're super rich. That's basically the physical. Flat, by the water, and sandy. But not too much else. So then going into the history. So the history of this place goes way back. Like 50,000 years ago, Stone Age. I guess were the first inhabitants of this place. One of the things they were known for basically in the, Stone Age, Bronze Age, whatever age, is the people who were here found out a way to make purple dye, which I think we had talked about this on another episode, purple dye was like super sought after. Yeah. Maybe it was Bahrain. I don't know, but purple dye was like, that's why the royalty was purple, but the only place I think for a while where you could get purple was from these, I guess it was from mollusks that they would
in the Mediterranean, harvest. Yeah.
And so that's what, like what they were known for in the ancient world was being the being able to create purple dye. How did they have, grape soda back in the day? What did they use? Was it just not dyed or?
Just had to use your imagination for their grape soda.
Clearly didn't have any grapes, so what would they make the flavor from?
I mean, it had to be something.
They had grapes.
This is where the made up artificial grape flavor comes from, right? Mm.
Modern era, it was kind of under the Persians. It was under the Portuguese for a little bit, like 1500s. It was under the Ottomans for a little bit, kind of moved around, bounced around to a bunch. And then 1820s, the House of Thani, I don't know. One of the two, it was created. And basically that dynasty is the one that's been ruling since. So everybody who's still ruling is this House of Thani that, got into power in 1820s.
Are they still the House of Thani?
Yeah.
Like that's still the, yeah.
Yeah, they still are. So basically it was this ruler that was ruling over this land or this group, this house. Then in 1916, it became an English protectorate or British protectorate. So I guess it was kind of just like a, colony basically. And then just like every other one, 1971, sometime in the early 70s when everything became a country, it got independence and became its own. So back then though, Qatar was like just sand. There was nothing there. There was a couple little ports, maybe a few little things. But then I guess within the past like 30 years is when they really started harvesting this liquid gas and blowing up as like a big powerhouse on the gas scene. So it's really been developing at like an insane rate. So speaking of the House of Thani, let's get into these rulers, these people, or it's really one guy at the top, but it's a whole family. So the emir is like the king, the ruler. They're like a kind of monarchy. It's basically there's the king, but then they also have some sort of parliament. But the current one is Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani. He's been ruling since 2013. His dad was the ruler before, but he's personally worth $2 billion. That's his like net worth. But then the whole family is $335 billion.
Jesus.
But the crazy thing, because you think of like a family that's ruling it and it's like, 15 people, like the house or whatever. It's like, there's 8,000 people in this family.
Oh my God, okay. Wow.
So this $335 billion is split up among 8,000 like descendants.
Do that math. Somebody do that math.
Yeah.
I want to know. 335 billion.
It's a lot.
I'm sure it's still a lot.
I mean,
people on the bottom aren't getting this. Like,
it's definitely
tier. Right, obviously. But I still want to know, like, on average, 335.
But it's still crazy that the guy who's at the top, the king, is 2 billion, which, you would think he'd have like a quarter of it or, like a higher percentage. But,
That's still 41. Can I do math?
41 million.
41 million for even per like person. The like third cousin who's
yeah.
If it broke down.
I mean, know. I know that, but sure. That's still you're like right. Yeah, it's, that's still it's a shitload. 41 million. That's still a lot of money.
So this guy who's a current ruler, got 3 wives, 13 children.
Fuck yeah. Matt.
Jason's out. Back in now.
I'm in.
If he can be part of the family.
Yeah, I'm in.
How do you get into it?
I can do stuff. I don't know.
So the crazy thing with them is they have like property everywhere, like super expensive mansions. So we had said with Brunei, they have like this insane mansion that's in Brunei. They had some property everywhere else. But these people are like, they have mansions everywhere. It's like London. They have Paris, all over the Middle East. They've invested in like numerous skyscrapers and stuff in London.
Mm-hmm.
The Empire State Building, Barclays Bank. They own PSG, soccer team.
Owns PSG?
Yeah.
Qatar?
So it's the Qatari royal family.
Okay.
What's PSG?
Paris Saint-Germain is like a soccer team from Paris.
One of the biggest soccer clubs in the world.
And they're known for recently, especially just like buying up all the like big name players. Yeah. So like spending $100 million on a player. One of the most like well-funded soccer teams. Right. I mean, they're like probably the richest soccer team.
Gold urinals.
Yeah.
Sure.
Maybe.
So British Airways, Volkswagen, Porsche, like they basically own portions of, you know,
a shitload
of companies.
Yeah. They're spreading the wealth.
They have this Lusail super yacht, $400 million. It's got a beauty salon, a private theater. They have a $500 million private jet that looks insane.
PJ.
Has a dining room and like a doctor's office.
Okay. On the jet?
On the jet.
Yeah, just in case.
And then this is in Doha, but the Doha Royal Palace it costs about 15 separate palaces that are all
connected
combined
with tubes,
or merged.
Like a hamster thing, you know, but like for humans and fucking epic and nice.
And that was
they're like those
$1 billion.
15 palaces
what
connected by
yeah.
tubes.
What do they call those tubes? The,
at the bank?
Yeah, there's like a
they go that's just do the
like
noise.
A specific term.
Everyone
for
knows
them
what
whatever.
You're talking about. If you do the noise, they go, do it, Matt. You're on camera.
That'd be pretty sick.
But this 15 palace was $1 billion just to make this crazy palace for him. And it's coated, like, the inside, there's rooms that are coated in gold. It's got, like, a 500-car parking garage. They have a palace in Oman next door, also coated in gold at parts. And with all their real estate in London, like, total, they're one of the biggest landowners in London as far as, like, property value goes. Like, they have, like, multiple, you know, palaces, so to speak, or you know, mansions
right.
in London that are
and just
super
property,
super high value.
Hmm.
And I think they have one residence in London that's just one place is $300 million, which I think is like the most expensive residence or piece of like, you know, piece of property in London. We'll say. So yeah, so these guys are super rich, but it's crazy. So as far as rich families go. Like rich royalty, they're still third. So I think the Kuwait royal family is second, and they're like almost have about the same, like 300 some billion.
That's crazy.
But the Saudi royal family is like 1.4 trillion.
Yeah,
they're like four or five times as much as
they own like these. 5 PSGs.
Yeah. So these people are rich, but Saudi rich is. Or Saudi royalty rich is a whole nother level. But yeah. So that's a little bit about the Thani family and Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani.
Much respect. Shout out. Country boys love you. We do. Don't ever hurt us. If we say anything wrong, we're just confused and ignorant.
Americans,
yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. And I think the other thing with this guy too, he's super into sporting events.
Right.
So that's, I think, one of the reasons why they pushed so hard for the World Cup to go there, buying PSG.
Right.
He's like really into sporting, soccer, stuff like that. All right, so let's get into the cultural stuff they got going on here. There's a lot. For like a small country, I feel like there's a lot of cultural stuff, a lot of stuff to do, a lot of different things. But one of the things here that I guess maybe it's kind of a sport or sport-like thing, but they're super into falcons. Falconry.
Okay.
Is that like are falcons native to Qatar?
I think they have them around. I don't know specifically if they bring them in, but I feel like they have falcons there.
There's definitely big birds that eat shit.
Yeah. Like they do have
right, desert, probably. Dead probably. Stuff dies, birds come, yeah.
Or live, like lizards and
sure.
Desert mice or something.
They're super into falcons. Like there's a whole market. There's a market you can go to in Doha called the Falcon Market where you can buy these falcons. And you can buy like there's like, I mean, it's a whole market. So not just the falcons, but like a falcon accessory shop, like falcon, like, yeah, whatever.
What
shop.
Else would you need for it?
The dude, chain, it's like
the
a big
chain thing, the little bracelet
you need
that attaches.
You need a glove.
Yeah, there's probably like a glove shop or like several glove shops.
Cool falcon hat.
Yeah. Like, I love falcons. Falcons rule.
A jersey that says I own a falcon yeah. on it.
Do you like falcons? Let's talk.
There's like a Spencer's Gifts for falcons.
Right.
So yeah.
Falcon
so,
mug. Yeah, you gotta have a mug.
Yeah. A falcon calendar store where you can go get your new calendar for the year.
Exactly.
But yeah, so it's not just like, oh, there's a store where you can buy a falcon here. There's a whole market dedicated to falcon stuff. So... How much do you think a falcon would go for? If
you're gonna I was wondering.
Like,
could you go personally buy a falcon?
And you can. We could walk in there and be like, give me this falcon.
I mean, is a falcon just a falcon? I thought a falcon was like a type of bird.
It is a type of
bird. Like a hawk.
No, I mean like
a... Oh, yeah. It is a... But there's like a tiny hawk. There's subgenres or varieties underneath.
There you go, yeah.
Like a blue hawk, maybe.
Right. Okay.
That's one, but...
Yeah.
So are some falcons better than others or whatever, cooler?
More there's definitely tiers of falcons. And I think there's levels of like how trained they are could affect the price, you know.
Yeah, but if you're buying the training probably is the price more than the like heritage.
But let's just say a run-of-the-mill falcon. What's a ballpark?
And we're talking about dollars here.
Yeah.
Obviously, because we don't know.
Unless you're using cutter bucks or whatever they use there. Cutter
yeah,
bucks.
I think it's like reals.
Oh, okay.
Reals.
Okay.
How much? What's
a
your real bid?
With cheese.
What's your bid for the bird?
$5,000, Bob.
I'm going to say $2,200.
Okay. So, yeah, I think
no,
it's...
No training.
with no training. I think on average I saw $1,000 to $3,000.
Nah.
But then, no, like $5,000 would be like a pretty good one. But then if you're getting a top-notch falcon, you're probably spending like $40,000, $50,000. $80,000 maybe more, I don't know. But
still.
If you're getting like a prize falcon, you're paying a lot for it. But
right.
But you could still go in there with a grand and hey, give me a falcon just to walk around with.
Fuck yeah.
So are there a lot of falcons in the city? Like are people just walking around with falcons on their wrists?
No, so I think it's more like a sport, like a pet.
Okay.
So it's something I think a lot of kids train them, and then you know you can train them to go.
Yeah, go get
stuff. Stuff. I don't know.
Go catch that rat for me or something. Like
brings you back a rat. Cool.
But
they can do tricks and I don't know all kinds of stuff. But this got me thinking. I feel like a falcon would be a sweet pet, but if you could have any exotic pet, what would you go for? And let's just say money and space isn't an option, but just as far as the pet itself goes, what would you want to have?
I don't
a tiger.
There, it's either two things.
A falcon.
And I think it'd be either a hyena, because that'd be pretty fucking sick.
Okay.
That'd be pretty good.
A hyena.
Yeah, I never thought about that.
That'd be pretty fucking gangster to have a hyena just hanging out with you all the time. Like put a gold chain on its neck.
Oh, yeah,
like I'm the shit.
Mm-hmm.
Or a cheetah. I think a cheetah would be pretty badass. I've never been a cat person, but I like cheetahs.
I think because they're not lazy, you know. They're like around, they're not like those house.
They got to work for their meals.
They might kill you. instead of just cut your eyeball or something.
Sure, yeah. Cat scratch fever. Well, for me, I think the first animal that pops in is, you know, like a chimp. You know, that'd be pretty sick.
Yeah,
like,
pretty a monkey smart. Would be some sort of ape would be cool.
And I've been learning more about these like orcas and how they're like getting more dangerous. And, you know, that's I'm thinking like if I could have an orca, like, but not SeaWorld shit. Like, I want to have like my own lake or something. I don't know. I don't want to have it in a tank. So if space isn't an issue, sure. But if we're talking land, a land creature, like a well-trained cobra, if that exists, I don't know if you can have...
Trained cobra?
A trained cobra.
Oh, yeah, you can train it with the little flute. Yeah, the flute.
I guess you can, yeah. I was like, oh, what? Oh, yeah.
I guess that's training. Is it training or like hypnotizing?
I don't know. Well, fuck it. I don't know. It just does what I say and it doesn't bite me. So that's the main thing.
This is Jason's world. He's got his own lake with an orca in it.
He rides his orca to go train the cobra.
Never mind. Never mind. An orca needs seawater to live.
Whatever. I'll add salt. He said space.
It's a brackish lake.
He said space and shit wasn't an issue. Okay.
Apparently, reality is not an issue either. Yeah.
All right.
It would be on Mars.
I want a downtown elephant, okay? I want an elephant on a fucking leash, all right? If you can have a falcon, I get a fucking elephant on a leash.
I feel like elephant's a pretty sweet one.
Yeah, it is. I should have gone there. Instead of the orca.
Ride an elephant
or orchestra.
Yeah. Orca seems way less appealing.
You almost need multiple orcas.
Obviously,
you need more than one. You need more than one orca. I think that's the issue.
Yeah.
I mean, a pack of orcas?
At least three.
I haven't seen that documentary. Never mind. We'll talk about that later.
Not written for the fans back at home.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm honestly like, maybe not a falcon, but like a hawk or something. Like, I feel like that would be sweet to have a bird of prey. Yeah. An owl. I don't know. Some sort of thing that you could go.
What about a vulture? Like a condor?
I feel like condor? Vultures are like the hyenas of birds of prey.
I think it'd be cool if Matt had a hyena and a vulture.
A vulture.
Like,
you'd
be kind of like a Disney hyena. Villain. You're starting. Like,
hyenas are badass, but they're also just kind of like.
They're evil.
Yeah, and they laugh at you.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah.
They're crazy looking. I don't know why I always liked them.
I think they're cool, but I think it's definitely. I don't know. It would definitely be weird owning a hyena. I think that's the reason why you've never heard of anybody.
Sick taking your hyena to the awesome dog park.
I'm pretty sure some gangsters in Africa own hyenas.
Yeah, but like, I feel like a tiger, like people have tigers. People have extravagant animals. Like you could, in theory, have an elephant. Hyena, I don't know. I feel like, I don't even know what you'd do with a hyena. I don't know.
They're like dogs, aren't they?
Yeah.
So what I mean, Jeff, so a hawk or a falcon?
I feel like a hawk or a falcon or an elephant would be awesome.
What's your third?
Third? I don't know. Maybe a tiger would be.
Sure. Just go big cat.
Yeah,
of course. Big cat's cool.
Okay. Big cat.
They can swim.
What about would you ever want like one of those giant dogs? You know what I mean? Like that's almost exotic. I know it's like.
No.
Like a Great Dane?
Yeah, maybe.
I'm thinking something that. Like, you'd have to get on the black market.
Sure. You're not allowed to have it.
There's no real fish that,
you're
I mean,
from
like,
Florida,
piranhas.
You get a Burmese python. They're all in the Everglades.
Yeah, see, I'm not a.
That's why they're in the Everglades, because people got them.
I wouldn't be into snakes. Like, owning a snake is further down on the line compared to, I don't know.
Would you rather have
a
snake?
I think a monkey,
though.
Would
you rather
have
a snake or a shark?
Pretty cool.
What?
A snake or a shark?
Snake.
Shark. Just because it's cooler.
Yeah, it is.
I own a shark.
So if you had
you own a snake. Oh, okay.
You'd have a hyena, a condor / vulture, and a shark.
I mean, like that dude in Ace Ventura.
He owned a shark. Yeah, it was fucking awesome. Yeah. It really was.
Okay, well, I think those are all good picks.
What do you think Champagne and Justin would pick, just since they're not here?
We're taking guesses.
Yeah, just guesses.
Okay.
Real quick.
Champagne, I don't know. What would he get?
I feel like Justin would be a monkey or ape dude.
Yeah, maybe a gorilla, like a big gorilla buddy.
Maybe. Maybe more like a chimp.
I could also see Champagne with a chimp, too. I could see him, like, cool buddy. Like, they'd really like to hang out. And they'd, like, he'd, like, jump in. I could see him always carrying him.
Phone him in really quick. Hey, what would you get?
Yeah. Maybe like an aardvark for champagne.
Oh, an aardvark. Yeah.
No, yeah. I don't know. I'm just trying to think of the most random
animal. Most random shit.
No, I can see, yeah, I can see a chimp. We'll get them to weigh in on the next one for their exotic pet.
Have them put it in the comments.
All right, so one of the other things to do, Souq Waqif is like the big market here. So that's one of the things if you're going to Doha, you got to go see and do. It's just like a big...
Oh, old, it's a market?
Old market. But okay. That's like the main... If I guess that's why I put it under cultural, not activities, because I guess it
goes
to both, but it's super old, and it's like... If you want to see the old school Qatar, this is where you go.
Cool.
Nice.
But yeah, it's a big market. Looks super cool. I'm sure you could probably get some food for your falcon there. Some sort of rat.
What if it was a robot cobra? You know, or like you could like program it legit and have to worry, rely on a flute.
Do they make those yet?
They will. They will. And the more we talk about it, the quicker it'll happen.
Yeah. I think robot cobra counts as an exotic pet.
Okay.
Speaking of robots, I guess that's a good segue. So one of the things you can do here, and this is a big pastime here, is they have camel racing.
Fuck yeah.
That's cool. But they have robot jockeys. So they're
what? Are you making this up?
No, this is a thing.
We need a YouTube video of this. Yeah,
this is like a big thing afterwards. There. So the jockeys are like, I don't know, they're not big, but they're basically just sit on the camel and it's like a whip that like rotates around.
Oh, so it's not like
just
a regular,
like
a
it's not like an Android.
Oh, okay. Well, you needed to kind of say it's like a shitty it's like a shitty Christmas thing. It was like
no, they're pretty high tech. Like, but I guess so.
Does somebody control it?
I think so. So I was watching the race, and all like the race is pretty long. It's like I don't know, like a mile or two, but it's on some sort of track, and as the camels are racing, like owners or the people who are maybe controlling this robot jockey are just driving in SUVs and they're all like cheering them on and yelling and stuff. So,
is this through the desert or is there like a track?
Yeah. So it's on a track in the desert, but it's a big thing there. So you can go there, bet on some camels. I feel like that'd be
fun.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the thing with the robot jockeys is it used to be, cause I guess with camels on like horses, they're, backs are kind of messed up and you can ride them like whenever you see someone riding a camel, it's always slow. They're not like trotting on a camel.
Right.
Cause I guess if you're a full grown adult and you're on a camel, it'll just fuck up their back. So they used to have like children as the jockeys racing the camels.
And then they
were just like
environmental.
Yeah. I guess they probably lost a lot of children and, accidents, because it had to have been pretty bad for them to be
trampled by camels. Yeah,
yeah.
Or it was one rich kid, the wrong kid.
Yeah, the wrong kid.
And his mom freaked the fuck out. Yeah.
The Karen or the Karen.
Oh, you do not want her into Cutter Karen. She will fuck you up.
She'll cut you.
She will.
Maybe it was
she cut you in the wrong fucking place.
One of the Al Thani family members.
Right.
We don't talk bad about them.
Yeah.
Have you eaten by falcons?
Have your picked eyes apart by up? Falcons at the dawn.
So yeah, I do think though that going to Qatar, you would have to go to one of these camel races and wager
cool.
a bunch of money on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want that robot.
Give me that underdog camel. Yeah.
That robot's whipping pretty good.
Do they build their own robots? Is this like building a droid?
Like battle bots? I don't know.
Camel
yeah,
droids.
If you look them up, they're maybe, I don't know, this big, and then it whips, but yeah, I think they control them somehow. When I first, I'm not going to lie though, when I first saw the thing and it said robot camel racing is big, I was expecting like robotic camels. And I'm like, what?
What is this shit? It's just half.
But then I was like, wait, it's just the jockeys? That's still cool, but...
They promised us robot camels.
So that's one of the cool things you'll do there. Just one of the other cultural things. You don't shake hands when you go here.
Good to know.
So
fist bumps
instead
only.
You place your right hand over your heart, and that's like saying what's up.
God bless America.
So
and Cutter.
So no shaking hands. So one of the things we kind of touched upon, at least with how fast it's developed and how much things have changed there culturally is because of the World Cup. So the 2022 World Cup was in Qatar, first time in the Middle East, first time in a having it during the winter time or not in the summer. So because of this World Cup, I think they developed crazy fast compared to the rest of the Middle Eastern countries that are similar, because they basically had to create this whole infrastructure, this whole, like, all the stadiums.
Right.
Everything they had to do, they had to make for this World Cup. Which, this is crazy just to put into perspective. It was the most expensive at $220 billion to get ready for this World Cup. Jeez. The previous two, which were Russia and Brazil, Russia was $14 billion. Brazil was $11 billion.
Oh, that's all?
Yeah. And South Africa, the one before that, was 3.5.
Wow.
Wow.
So that's impressive. 220.
That's crazy.
Is insane.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
That's like small. 20 times as much of what the other ones were.
And it's a small country.
Nuts. So it's
$220 billion into like basically one city.
Yeah. And all of that. So all of that development, it's like, yeah, their infrastructure, their hotels, just everything. It's like, dude, $220 billion, nuts.
Yeah.
It's not just like the stadiums. It's like the whole
like
country change. Some stuff with this World Cup. It was kind of a legendary World Cup just because a lot of new things happened here, but it had the most goals scored at 172. I think there was two others that were 171, so just barely had the most goals scored. Most penalty shootouts.
Yeah, there's a lot of those.
At 5. And then with Messi, like, Argentina won the World Cup. Spoiler alert.
Fuck, I was just going to watch that.
Yeah, I was watching all the games, the highlights. I missed it. But
just getting around to it.
But Messi and Argentina won, but Messi had like a crazy tournament. And I knew he did well just from watching it. But when I was actually looking up like the stats at how well, it's crazy. He became the first player to score in each stage of the tournament. So there's the group stage, round of 16, quarterfinal, semifinal, final. So not just in this tournament, but across all of his World Cups, he's the only person who's scored in every single level of the tournament. He's the first player.
He's good at soccer?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just a little bit.
He's good, but it's insane on an international level, like how well he performed at World Cups.
Right.
And how old is he? Or was he?
35, 36.
Oh, so still in this, but.
He's winding down, he's played in the most World Cups. Yeah. As far as like most appearances, 26 appearances.
You think he could beat Pele in their in his prime?
Yeah, he's definitely. Oh,
okay. Yeah,
yeah. He's the first player to win Player of the Tournament in two World Cups. So he was like the golden ball at two tournaments. He in all World Cups, he's been involved in 21 goals, so 13 goals and 8 assists, which is crazy because usually at a World Cup you'll do good at one, but. It's rare that you find players who are like exceptional all through it.
Right.
In this one, he had the highest number of shots, created the most plays from open or the most plays from open play. So not including like set pieces, assisted the most goals and won the most fouls.
How many assists did he have?
He had 3. So he was tied. I think there was 3 other players who also had 3, but up until the World Cup, like that's what Qatar was kind of known for a while. It was just like, oh, it's that country in the Middle East that's hosting the World Cup.
Right.
Like, I feel like the World Cup really was a big turning point for them, or I don't know. It's crazy because, you know, like Bahrain, it's like, oh, that we still kind of think that, but like with Qatar, you're kind of like, yeah, this is a well-known place.
I have to see how long that lasts. It still was just 6 months ago.
Or yeah, it was like a year. Ago. Yeah.
It is almost a year now. Holy shit.
I guess since the last games, maybe about 10 months.
November, right?
That World Cup really was like a big deal for them. It really changed a lot of things. Yeah. So. And Messi won for a reason. But I didn't realize just looking at the stats. I was like, dude, I knew he was good, but
damn,
that's crazy.
Yeah, it's true.
All right, so food and drink. I think it's typical Middle Eastern here. I forget what the dish was. It was like, I know I'm saying it wrong, but something like maguba. I don't know. I know I'm definitely like not even saying it right at all, but it was kind of like a porridge. porridge thing. But then I think a lot of the other meals, you know, it's lamb or, you know, meat, rice.
Right.
The food looks pretty good. Dates. Dates are big here.
Figs.
Figs. There was a...
Dried figs. I got some in their room. Why don't we can have some right now. Costco's best.
There was like a tamarind juice that I saw that kept coming up that a lot of people have. It's like a sweet, like almost like a grape juice, I guess. But in that market, the famous market, there's like guys who are like dressed up in silver and they have this like jug and the, I don't know, they're making this tamarind juice. Hmm. So that's a big thing. But I think you can get food from all over here. So it's pretty diverse, especially after the World Cup, because you have all these people from all over. And
yeah.
But yeah,
they got KFC, they got Domino's.
Yeah,
probably.
But one thing that I did see that kept coming up, I guess in the Marriott there's a 100-meter buffet.
That's insane.
A giant buffet. But yeah, I feel like you'd have to go at least to see what a 100-meter buffet looks like.
You got
to
eat it.
You got to eat from each meter of the 100-meter buffet.
That's, I mean,
that's the
if you ate a meter a day,
that's my sport.
Be 100 days. Yeah.
So. That's a lot.
Yeah, that's like, I mean, let's just say this table's about a meter.
Yeah.
So
that's fucking
100 of those.
Damn. I could do it.
Yeah, you could do it in a day. Just going into the activities. What are you going to see and do there? There is a lot to see and do. So a lot of like stuff in Doha, like the city actually looks pretty crazy. It's super modern, but they've basically designed this city. So it's like if you were creating a city in the last
like a modern
20 years and we're like, oh, we could do this differently. We could do this. Like,
right.
You know, it's been around for a lot longer, but the actual infrastructure and stuff, apparently there's like AC units that are built into the walls so you don't even see them, but it's like cooling from, you know, like it's like a hidden system. They have, I guess, a series of tunnels that goes all under the whole city. So all the trash and like deliveries and stuff are just like, you don't even see it going on. Mm. And then they have crazy skyscrapers, crazy stuff. There's the National Museum of Qatar, which is this huge museum. It looks like a flower. But it was designed, I think it was designed by the guy who designed the Louvre in Paris. They have the Pearl, which is like a man-made island in the center of the city, I think, with shops, canals, entertainment district. But basically, I feel like if you're going there, it's like you're going to Vegas or something where it's just everything's crazy and over the top.
Right.
There's Al Zubarah Fort, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. I think it's a little bit outside of Qatar, but it's basically like super old fishing village ruins. Hmm. We said they have beaches so you can get your tan on. And then also like Formula One, MotoGP, they have a track there. So
do they have a race? That
attracts a lot of people.
Does F1 have a race in?
Yeah.
They do?
I think them and Bahrain both do.
No shit. I haven't paid attention
to this and season, so. UAE, but I don't know how like, sometimes they'll skip over ones or, you know, go couple it years always, or whatever. It
changes, yeah.
But yeah, they do have a track.
Huh.
So lots to see and do.
Can't you, don't they not allow drinking in this country?
Right. So yeah, I actually meant to get to that on the food and drink part of it. But yeah, so you can drink. It's not acceptable. Like it's not like being drunk in public isn't acceptable.
Okay.
Or it's not, it's like frowned upon.
Right.
But they do have bars there. I think mostly in like hotels, like you can go to hotel bars.
Okay.
I don't think there's like clubs or nightlife, but there's enough places where I think you could go around and drink. And it's basically like you go in, you drink, and then as long as you're not acting drunk,
right?
They don't really care.
I just remember that being a big deal during the World Cup. Like everybody's like, oh, you can't drink.
Yeah. So the family that rules, they are on the stricter side. Like in Bahrain, I think you could just drink and they're kind of like, well, we don't like it, but well, we don't care if you do. Right. Like here, it's like they really don't like it. There's places you can drink. They have one liquor store in the whole country. Jeez. But I don't think you can. I think you have to be a citizen that's non-Muslim or something. But it's crazy because only 10% of the country are, you know, natively Qatari. So most of the people there are from somewhere else. But their law. They're definitely like strict.
Right.
Not cool with drinking. So it's probably like you have to go out of your way, but you can go to some hotel bar and drink. I did see something where it was like, you know, $15 a beer. Or
yeah,
it's not, sure it's not cheap. Not cheap, but right. It's so definitely doable.
Completely illegal. Yeah, I didn't catch all that.
And I read some, I don't know, some article about somebody who lived there, like an American who was stationed or lived there for a while, and they were like, we drank all the time, but it was at people's houses. You're kind of like, it's like being in high school where you're kind of like sneaking it, but yeah, you're still more doing so. It.
Kind of right. Makes it fun again. Yeah. It's kind of risky. You might get her head chopped off. I don't know.
See, so I feel like here you'll just get a slap on the wrist unless you're like streaking and
blacked
out. Dude, the Sultan,
those were drunk. It's not the Sultan, dumbass. Well, we're in trouble.
They're not as strict as other places for sure. So I think that it's just kind of like if you're walking around drunk, yeah, maybe you'll get locked up. If you're being obnoxious or something, but they're also like, they're super modern, have a lot of people from all over. So I think they're kind of, I don't know, more accepting of it than maybe some other countries. They're still pretty strict though.
Right, so. Right. That's what I understood.
So yeah, so the boys could cut loose a bit, but
okay.
Just hide it. So what are we thinking? What's the verdict on this place?
I feel like I'd have to go if there was a reason to, like a sporting event. Like
yeah, definitely.
I'm gonna say I would definitely go.
It's definitely intriguing.
For sure,
I'd want a reason to go.
Yeah.
At first it was kind of like I don't know, but then after seeing all the videos and different things on it, it looks pretty awesome.
Yeah. I mean, seeing a cool modern city like
that's yeah, different. Like the city looks cool. Sick.
Yeah.
It's cool. They have like the old kind of mixing with the new at certain points. You could definitely find enough stuff to do. Like you could rent a jet ski there.
Fuck,
and cruise
yeah,
around.
I'm going. You didn't tell me that before. You didn't say it. You said
that was like one of the things you can do.
Been on a jet ski.
So yeah, like cruise around Doha on a jet ski.
Fuck yeah.
Sounds pretty cool.
And I think it's cool because like when I do get that girl and she's on the back of my jet ski and all the 3-to-1 dudes and they see me, I'm like,
yeah.
She's back there smiling.
Like be all jealous.
Two. Maybe I have a two hussies in the back of my jet ski. Or like the big ones, you know? I don't know.
The big hussies?
Girls or the jet skis?
Hey, yeah, that's maybe. No, I don't know what they have to offer. I don't want to say no.
But yeah.
Maybe they're part of the Thani family.
Mm. Yeah,
I'm going to say I'm in.
We're in.
All right. I'd go if you guys went.
That's not the show. Would you go?
I think I'd go to check it out. That sounds like enough cool shit to go to see.
Yeah, it definitely seems pretty cool. All right. So that's a unanimous one on.
And I'm going to say Champagne and Justin would go.
Yeah. Probably. We'll speak maybe. For them.
Yeah.
Where next? Where do we want to go next?
I don't know. Do you already have some options in mind? I haven't thought about it.
I guess let's think of a region.
What continent have we not been to in a while?
So this is technically Asia.
Right.
Last one we went to was South America.
Have we done any Central America yet? I know it's kind of similar to South,
yeah,
but...
Yeah,
we did Belize.
Oh, and we then, did Belize. Yeah.
We did Dominica not too long ago,
right.
Which is North American. But I don't know. We could do Europe or I feel like Europe or Africa.
I feel like we haven't done Europe in a while.
Let's go to Europe. I think we did Moldova.
We did Monaco.
Moldova was in Monaco, you know, but we haven't done.
Okay, so we could do Malta, Vatican City.
Ooh, yeah.
Either one of those would be pretty interesting.
Yeah, Malta would be cool.
Okay, maybe... I don't know. Maybe we'll do Malta. We got to see. I guess we'll check and
we
see if
talk to
the
foreign minister, get permission, flight patterns, traffic control.
We got to see how it stands on the population and size ranking. But right. I feel like those are the two smallest that we haven't gone to. But yeah, okay. I don't know. Excellent. All right, we'll go to Europe next, and we'll see you there.
All right, country boy, country boys out.